Hello, this is Hot Indonesia, and welcome to all of you watching us in Johannesburg. I'm Dalton Taranaka in Jakarta, and here is this week's HI Hot List. Reopening rules. The country's major resort destination officially open again to international visitors, but are they coming? Melbourne meltdown. While we're opening up, others are fighting off the latest wave of COVID-19. We talk with former Indonesia resident Trevor Bilney in Australia. And captive audience. People panicked when major social media platforms went dark. Did we? Here, my co-host, Sandrina Malakiano, is Deputy CEO of Polmark Indonesia from her home in South Tangerang. And Milly Lukito, CEO of the Mobiliari Group, on the road again in Jimbaran, Bali. Hot topic number one, reopening rules. Officially, one of the world's best tourist destinations is open again for international guests. But realistically, it will take a bit of time before Bali's beaches, shops, and restaurants are busy again. That's because, as of the taping of this program, no flights from overseas have landed. And the reason why, say industry leaders, is that airlines aren't certain that the island is indeed open for business. I don't know what's going on, Milly. Do you?
Yes, I'm now in Bali, Dalton, and I have talked to several general managers and a lot of people actually from Bali. They are all very apprehensive of the government's plan to open. It opened yesterday. So we don't know yet of how the international tourists might or might not come. Especially they are apprehensive because the tourists are still due to do 5-day quarantine.
One would think that the leaders would have had confirmation from overseas stakeholders that they were ready for reopening this week. Sanjita, is it wishful thinking on our part? Why aren't we ready?
I want to say no, it's not wishful thinking. But unfortunately, Dalton, we all know that this pandemic has not only hit Bali or Indonesia. The entire world has been crippled by it, and this pandemic has really taken its toll. It has really affected people's lives in many fields, including and especially in terms of financial income. Last week, we talked about hotels in Bali preparing to reopen while struggling to cover the financial needs for maintenance and other preparations required before reopening. Now, despite our high hopes that international tourists will immediately come to Bali, we also need to realize that so many people around the world have been forced to tighten their belts, use funds only for basic necessities, save money.
Sanjina, I don't think it's the budget that's preventing people from coming.
Traveling, especially going on holiday to other countries, is surely not an option for many, Dalton.
Right. But the ones who are coming are not coming now because they're not sure what's going to happen when they arrive.
And they're still afraid that because COVID is still around, some simply just can't afford it. Some have the money, but still think they'll save it for rainy days. But you know, the fact that on the other side in Bali alone, if the hotels reopen and there are no guests coming, you know what's going to happen. Financially, it would become such a burden because they have to spend money to pay people, to maintain, to put electricity on and everything, the pools. So, you know, it is really good to see that the number of domestic tourists visiting Bali continues to increase. Very slowly, though, we are seeing that the island is starting to return to life. But international tourists, I'm not sure.
Well, yeah, but my point is, my question again is, why haven't we set everything in place before we announced the October 14th opening? You know, one hotel owner I talked with in Bali this week is very frustrated. And Milly, you said you talked to a bunch of industry people. He said that he believed the announcement of the reopening date was just to give people hope. And that it buys more time until everything gets ready. I mean, aren't we out of time, Milly?
Yes, we are out of time. But some hotel owners are actually very hopeful that they can do this successfully. And they are actually ready to accept international tourists again. However, they are again very doubtful of the fact that international arrivals, tourists, have to do 5-day quarantine. And some of them may have only 14 days to spend as a holiday in Bali. If they have to quarantine for 5 days, that cuts off a lot of their holiday allotment plus, of course, increased budget for them.
Well, I think you go down from 8 to 5. I mean, that's something. 5 is a lot better than 8. But I don't think that's the issue. Yeah, I understand. We all wish that there was no quarantine, even when we travel abroad, and many countries have done away with a quarantine. You know, ladies, I want to believe that the government has the best of intentions in this announcement of the October 14th. You know, there should have been, for example, a ceremony at the Bali airport yesterday when the first flight and the first foreign visitors return, right? I mean, that's going to be the big news and a nice photo op. But the reality is that it's not going to happen for at least several more weeks, if not months, right, Sandrina?
Yes, I'm sure it's going to take time. People might start to come to Bali, but very small in numbers, especially compared to the times before the pandemic. But I agree, Dalton, with Millie. Mandatory quarantine, even though only 5 days, is another strong reason why people would not come. Even 5 days is for you, perhaps. I wouldn't want to be cooped up in a room for 5 days. So the option, the idea of making a quarantine area, for example, the area of Nusa Dua, where tourists could still go to the beach, be outdoors, play golf, this would surely be a lot more attractive for tourists.
Yeah, a lot of other countries are doing away with their quarantine for fully vaccinated and COVID-free, you know, certified visitors. So why can't we go that step? But at least we're taking a half step.
I agree, because I went to the States, I went to Istanbul, no quarantine. But Istanbul now, you know, is facing like really a spiking increase in COVID numbers. So the challenge is that for the government to be able to make a very good system to ensure safety, create a safe quarantine zone for both the people in quarantine as well as those working there in the surrounding areas.
Okay, well, we'll monitor this, and every week let's see how many visitors start coming. It'll be a handful at best, because there are no international flights scheduled to land in Bali, so they cannot come physically, but we'll keep track of it. Hot Indo will continue shortly with Melbourne Meltdown. COVID problems in the world's most locked down city. We get the view from the ground from former Indonesian chef Trevor Bilney next.
Welcome to Yoga Bliss. Dropping your hands to the mat, just step it back
and out and up to the side.
Up through your fingertips. Reach your right hand back behind your head. Put your hands separate forward and then start.
Yoga Bliss, only on the Indonesia Channel.
Untukmu di dalam lubuk hatiku. Tolong
You are watching Hot Indonesia with Sandrina, Millie, and me. Here's hot topic number two, Melbourne meltdown. When the number of coronavirus cases began rising this fall, Australia's second biggest city went into hard lockdown again. The latest restrictions are set to run until October 26th, making it the most lockdown city in the world at 267 days in total. Among the tough rules, residents must stay at home between 9 p.m. and 5 in the morning. Trevor Bilney has spent 20 out of the past 25 years working as a chef and food consultant in Indonesia. He now joins us from his hometown. Trevor, I guess you're there because you're stuck there, not by choice, because of travel restrictions here. First question to you, sir. Describe what it is, a real lockdown, unlike what we've had here.
Well, first of all, it happens with very short notice. The second thing is that there's in place financial assistance for people who lose their jobs. So they'll close it down within a day. At the moment, it's $750 a week if you're out of work because of COVID, the so-called disaster payment. Yesterday, there were 70,000 people tested for COVID. So there's a very, very strong testing regime. If I'm tested and I cannot work while I wait for the result, there's $450 in place to try and encourage me not to go to work when I know that I'm sick. The wastage is something else. The wastage is criminal.
Yeah. Well, so there is some relief if you are forced to lockdown. What I mean was briefly describe what you can and cannot do under the so-called hard lockdown.
So, for example, I like to ride my bike. The limit is 5 kilometers. It's now being lifted up to 15 kilometers. The malls are shut. Essential services are open, so we can go to the doctors. If you want to go to work, if you're lucky enough to have a job, you do need a letter. You do need a letter from the government. Pretty much public transport, whilst it's open, it's kind of frowned upon. So our mobility is very, very limited. The kids cannot go to school. So there's been a whole year or year and a half of homeschooling.
Okay, I got the picture. You're pretty much limited in what you can do. What was the problem, Trevor? What caused the lockdown? Was it a spike because of variants, irresponsible reaction to protocols, or what?
Okay, then. So the initial spike came from the quarantine system. So you're talking about Bali before and the hotels. Hotels were never designed. They do not have the air conditioning for there to be a group of people in there that are infectious or are potentially infectious. So the actual spikes, initial spikes, came from the hotel quarantine system.
Wow. Okay. I didn't know that. Go ahead.
And then in the second instance, there was very, very strong denial of what we're actually going through. So people continue to struggle to live a normal life.
Okay, combination of things. Yeah, no, that's been the problem here as well. Sandrina, your question for Trevor?
What I'd like to know is that Trevor, well, first of all, I can't imagine how hard it must have been for the people living there, having to live under such a long and strict lockdown. Here in Indonesia, we have not been under strict lockdown, only different levels of restrictions and no regular financial support from the government. So people still go out and struggle to earn a living as they have to eat and pay for basic necessities. So how are the people in Melbourne now facing the situation, being cooped up, being locked down? You said they have financial aid or support from the government, but is it like ongoing regularly as long as the lockdown? And what about vaccination? I mean, are the people there, is the vaccination level has covered most of the people or not? Because I don't understand, with such lockdown, it's not becoming easier for you people there.
All right then, so to answer the first question, things like youth suicide, domestic violence have gone off the Richter scale. Those statistics, all-time high. In answer to your second question about vaccine, there's incredible resistance to being vaccinated. So the Commonwealth government has said, we will release you when we reach a certain vaccination level. The state government, they're also in conflict, you may say, because the people living in the state, well, if you're vaccinated to 80%, we'll release you. But there's such resistance to being vaccinated. We're kind of stuck. We're kind of stuck at the moment.
Well, what resistance? I mean, don't they believe in science? Is it a choice matter like they have in the U.S.? Why resistance, Trevor?
Yeah, so for example, whilst we recognize the Chinese vaccine, because we have a huge Chinese population here, mainly in universities, we never actually bought a vaccine from China. And there was a whole mystique around that. The government has, in my view, failed to engage with the population at a country level, at a rural level, at a suburban level. They've failed to engage with the people. As a former school teacher, you need to do more than just talk to people. You need to engage with them. People are not engaged. They don't believe in the vaccine.
Okay, Millie, question for Trevor.
Yes, I remember Melbourne is a university city. A lot of millennials and young people, how are they taking this, being cooped up and locked down?
Yeah, so the whole question around the education industry is a massive one for us. I mean, Melbourne is incredibly dependent on the dollars and the cultural capital that come in from the university sector. And when the universities went to delivering classes online, this was really, really hard for all my friends who have English as a second language. Incredibly challenging. And so they were isolated from their schools, and they were isolated from their families, and they were isolated from their communities. A lot was done to support them, but however, many of those people also occupy the casual sector of employment, so under 20 hours a week. So those jobs all fell away.
Yeah. Trevor, being a man of two countries, and I know you prefer being here if you had your choice at the moment, what is your advice to Indonesia and Indonesians as we head out of the toughest part of the pandemic?
Okay, my advice to Indonesia, if I may say so, is stay humble. Remember that, you know, people are infecting people. The virus needs people to transfer to the next person. And it's just stay humble. I mean, when you go to the post office, wear a mask and consider the people that you're interacting with.
So follow health protocols, exactly what we've been advocating during this whole pandemic. Okay, Trevor Bilney, former Indonesia chef and food consultant, thank you very much for those insights from Melbourne, and hope to see you back here in Indonesia soon.
Oh yeah, me too. I'm on the first plane.
Okay, more Hot Indo is ahead. Captive audience, what did you do when social media went down?
Welcome to Foodiepedia. Every week in this program, I will introduce you to one of Indonesia's fabulous food items. Yummy.
Beautiful. Now, I'm ready to cook. Let's go to the kitchen.
It's done. Let's meet to eat.
Foodiepedia on the Indonesia Channel.
Chen Bingen, a visiting Net Viet in Hanoi.
I'm Thairat Thongya of Thailand's Thairat TV in Bangkok.
I'm Monica Somborat from the National Television of Cambodia in Phnom Penh.
I'm Raymond Goh of Malaysia's TV Tiga in Kuala Lumpur.
I'm Glenda Chong of Singapore's Channel News Asia.
I'm Sachin Tommy of the Indonesia Channel at the ASEAN Secretariat in Jakarta.
This is your weekly look into the dynamic Southeast Asia region.
ASEAN Today on the Indonesia Channel. The best of Bali, only on the Indonesia Channel.
You are watching Hot Indonesia from Jakarta. Hot topic number 3, captive audience. The social media giant Facebook said it was an internal technical problem that caused its various platforms to be inaccessible on October 4th. If you tried to log into your Instagram Messenger or WhatsApp account, you were shut out for 6 hours. 3.5 billion users were in the dark. And that's literally what happened here in Indonesia, because the outage happened mostly overnight while we were sleeping. Or most of us were sleeping, but those of us awake were left to ourselves. No selfie posts, no gossip chats. Millie, did you panic? Were you up? And what are we supposed to do if it happens again?
Very panicked, Dalton. You know, apparently, when we pick up our phone and we start our messaging app or any other app, our dopamine hormone is released. So that hormone is the same as when one is addicted to smoking, drinking, and even drugs. So I think 3.5 billion of those people who panic, including myself, are, we can safely call addicted, an addict.
Yeah, I mean, you're giving us a medical reason now to use our phones. Is that what you're doing?
Yes, of course.
Okay, Dr. Millie, thank you. Now, you know, I've said before that we should have a phone-free day, like we have car-free day, where people actually are legally bound to put away their mobile devices and actually have conversations and kind of look around and see, wow, there's a tree. Oh, that's a bird. Enjoy what's going on around you. Am I dreaming, Sandrina?
Well, if we don't do something to change this, then yes, I would agree that you're dreaming, Dalton, but you know, it is actually something we could change. I would like to tell, I was not asleep at that time when everything went down, but I just said, okay, technical error or problem. I just put my phone away because I have been for some time trying to reduce my screen time. And it was not quite, and if I really needed to contact somebody, I would just call. Now, for example, talking about change, every time I have a gathering, you know, when we go out for dinner or just for coffee with family or friends, we implement this rule. All mobile devices, gadgets, must be put in the middle or the end of the table. The first person who takes his or her phone before the gathering is declared over will have to pay for the entire bill. This actually works. And at the end of the gathering, everybody actually admitted that they really had a good time just engaging with others, really talking, enjoying each other's company. We just need to remind ourselves and others that gadgets should not invade and own our lives. If we do not do this, there will be most probably a very high price we will have to pay, losing real human connections with our family and friends.
Yeah, then you couldn't invite Millie because she wouldn't stand for that rule, right, Millie?
I'll call.
Right.
Oh, no. You will have to follow the rules. And
come on, Millie, one meal. You can do it, can't you?
I can. I can.
I will confiscate your phone.
I'm a social media addict.
Try it, Millie. You might like it.
Dalton. Okay. Yeah. Let's just confiscate.
Maybe I have to go to a retreat or something.
Yeah. Go to go to a place where you are forced to lock your phones up. Okay. It is feedback time now, and this post on the YouTube page of our partner TV One came from Adri on the release of sex offender Saipul Jamil. He can move on with his life, but should be nowhere near the public. And Triasi had this to say about the arrival of deep dish pizza to Indonesia. I love burgers, kebabs, and hot dogs more than pizza. Oh, you are so wrong, Triasi. Okay, here's how to contact us with your feedback. Email at hotindo@theindonesiachannel.com or comment through our Hot Indonesia or Indonesia Channel Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, and YouTube pages. Final word, Sandrina.
For the last few months, I have been working with friends with the main purpose of creating food resilience in Bali. Creating edible gardens where people could come and take vegetables for free, give seeds and assistance to the people so they can also plant their own healthy chemical-free veggies at home. I have also transferred my own garden at home into a small veggie farm. This is actually not only a good thing to do as it will reduce spending, but also really enjoyable. So for people in big cities where land is scarce, we could create hydroponic gardens and still can plant a lot. So I would like to invite everyone to do the same thing. We not only can help ourselves, but could also help others as well by sharing the harvest and seeds. Let's start gardening. It's really fun and healthy.
Final words, Millie.
Well, I have been in Bali for 2 weeks now, and I have been around in Bali and talked to a lot of general managers of hotels, restaurant owners, and let me tell you, Bali is ready, and it has reopened yesterday, so please, return, enjoy Bali, and don't forget to take pictures and, of course, post it in your social media accounts and with a hashtag #KemBali or Return to Bali.
And my final words, who wants to go listen to a live band? Spend a nice evening out with friends? I do. The things that keep your soul alive have been missing for too many months. If you've been vaccinated and follow health protocols, it's okay to begin enjoying simple pleasures again. Let's dance, ladies. And that is Hot Indonesia for this week. For Sandrina Malacchiano and Millie Lukito, I'm Dalton Tanonaka. Thank you very much for watching. Please join us again next time.